You're listening to the number one fitness, health, and entertainment podcast. This is Mind Pump. Now, in today's episode, we answer fitness and health questions that are asked by our audience. But the way we open the episode is with an introductory portion. This is where we talk about current events. We mention our sponsors. We talk about scientific studies around health and fitness. I'm going to give you a rundown of today's entire episode. By the way, the intro portion lasted 39 minutes. So if you want to fast forward to the questions, at around 39 minutes, that's when we start answering those fitness questions. So we open up by talking about the finale of The Mandalorian.
Oh, man.
Oh, that was great.
Did that not give you the feels?
Oh, it was awesome. Then we talk about another show on Netflix called Song Exploder that I'm going to try and get my wife to let me watch now.
Yeah, it explodes things.
Then we talked about Blue Zones, and there's a controversy around Blue Zones. Were the numbers accurate? Maybe there were some issues there. Then we talked about North Korea executing someone because they listened to the radio. Yep, sounds like a normal day over there.
Yikes.
Then I talk about the great weekend I had with my wife and my new son. Great time. Good time bonding with everybody. Adam talked about being an abusive father to his dog.
Poor Mozzie.
By the way, he uses Brain FM to calm the dog down and his son down. Brain FM, if you listen to it, you can meditate. It can help you focus, help you sleep. Mind Pump's got a hookup. Go to brain.fm/mindpump. Get 20% off. Go check it out. Then I talk about the homeless guy with the crazy eyes who denied my money. Felt rejected.
I don't think he saw you.
Then we talked about a study showing that people who got poor sleep had a lot more visceral body fat. That's the fat around your organs. By the way, if you use blue light blocking glasses during the day, studies show that you sleep much better. Our favorite company for blue light blocking glasses is Felix Gray. And Mind Pump's got something for you. Go check them out. Go to felixgrayglasses.com. That's felixgrayglasses.com/mindpump. Use the promo code Mind Pump. Get 5% off. Then we talk about fog nets in Peru. There's a new strain of COVID. And California may be losing power with electoral votes. Then we got into the fitness questions. Here's the first one. This person wants to know what the pros and cons are of circuit training. The second question, this person wants to know how long it will take to lose 75 to 100 pounds. The third question, this person wants to know what we think of gastric bypass surgery. And the final question, this person wants to know what career we have tremendous respect for. Also, there's 2 days left for the December bundle promotion. So here's what we did. We took some of our programs and we put them together in bundles, discounted them, and put them together for different types of people. So here are the three bundles that we put together. One of these will probably work well for you. The first one is the new to weightlifting bundle. If you're a beginner to working out with resistance, that's the bundle for you. It's about 9 months of exercise programming. The second bundle is the body transformation bundle. This is great if you're intermediate. So if you've got about a year or so of experience, of consistent experience working out, that's the one for you. That one also is about 9 months of exercise programming. And the third bundle is advanced. This is for all of you fitness fanatics. It's the New Year Extreme Intensity Bundle, also about 9 months of exercise programming. In other words, we give you all your exercises, your workouts, reps, sets, there's video demos, everything you need to follow those programs. By the way, they also all come with a year of free access to our private forum. So if you want to ask questions about fitness, exercise, nutrition, if you want to talk about funny memes, that's also happening in there. You can also find Adam, Justin, and myself in there. It's a year of free access if you sign up for any one of those bundles. Go check them out. See if one of them works for you. It's at mapsdecember.com. That's mapsdecember.com. And again, there's only 2 days left for these promotional bundles. Go check them out.
And it's t-shirt time.
Ah, shit, Doug. You know it's my favorite time of the week.
We have two big winners this week. For Apple Podcasts, we have G. Hudak. And for Facebook, we have Cameron Davis. Both of you are winners. Send the name I just read to itunes@mindpumpmedia.com. Include your shirt size and your shipping address, and we'll get that shirt right out to you.
Hey, so that finale, huh?
Oh, Mandalorian.
Bro, that was so good.
That gave
good.
Me all the feels.
How about Justin at first hadn't seen it? I hadn't seen it either, but Sal watched it first.
Oh, so mad.
And Sal's like, oh my God. Yeah. Justin's like, don't say anything.
Shut up.
So then, of course, we were just Sal and I were going back and forth making shit up.
Yeah, they're saying like Jar Jar came back.
Hey, so like, fuck you guys. At the end, by the way, this is a spoiler alert for if you haven't watched it by now, though.
You're not a real fan if you haven't watched it now.
Did you guess that it was Luke right when he came in with the X-Wing?
Yes, 100%. Of course. Yeah. Of course.
The X-Wing, dude. Come on. And I feel like I called it on the podcast. I'm pretty sure I could go back.
So I knew it was coming when we saw how badass those, what are they called, the Dark Shoulder, whatever.
Dark Knights or Dark Soldiers?
Yeah. I saw how much the Mandalorian almost got his ass kicked by one. I knew like
Dark Troopers.
I was like, the only person who's saving this is like a badass Jedi. And so when it was coming, I was like, oh,
bro, but why was totally. Luke is such a, like, I guess he's like that bad of a bat. He crushed that one with the Force.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah.
Well, you know what it was? It's totally like an homage because remember in Rogue One where Darth Vader, they had that scene finally, they gave it to the nerds of like his true power. Like he goes onto the ship and then just starts picking people up, choking them out, slicing through everybody. So they like, they did like a parallel scene with Luke coming in and saving the day like that. It was so bad.
Now, what you have to school me on, Justin, is I don't understand timelines right now.
I know.
This is the
it's all over the place.
This one is after the original trilogy.
Yeah.
So it's after...
But it's after the fall of the Empire, right? So, you know, Luke is still kind of going around. And so this is before, I think, Ben Kenobi and him really, like, connect. So I think that that's going to be the next direction they're going to go.
What do you mean, before him and Ben Kenobi? I thought they did already.
No. No. Do you see how young Luke was?
He has to have connected because he's got all the...
He's got the hand, bro. Remember he had the glove? His hand already got cut off.
He had the glove and he also had the power of the Force. Like he learns that through Obi-Wan and Yoda.
No, not Ben Kenobi. What am I talking about? Ben Solo.
Oh.
Yeah. I mixed the two together.
Han Solo? You mean?
Han Solo's son. Right? Oh, Ben Kenobi, he's Kylo Ren. So this is all kind of like, there was no real story of like him. They gave us like a little brief synopsis like in the movies.
Yeah, I'm so lost on the
this
time.
Is literally,
I know it is, it's tough, dude.
This is literally right after the first trilogy. Literally.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So what happens with Grogu then? Because
I know.
He takes him, but then we don't hear about anything else.
I know. I don't know. Like, because obviously they're moving on, and you saw that like little teaser they had for, for Boba Fett.
Yes.
In his series. Yes. I can't wait for that.
Now, you didn't watch it past the credits.
I did after you guys said something.
Yeah.
Well, Katrina and I watched it together. And it was funny because I really wanted to watch it. And she's like, well, you know, walk the boys? I'm like, no, I'll walk them afterwards. Let's watch this. So I watched it. And then I know they had to go to the bathroom. They were all like moving the poor dogs. I made them wait that long. And so as soon as it was over, I got up and walked them. And then she was still in the room watching. And then I get a text while I'm out there watching. She's like, oh, my God, you missed the end. Yeah. And then you guys said that to me. I was like, oh, shit.
Yeah that's going to be good, dude. I think the next one's going to be good. Yeah.
I'm actually excited. Like that definitely rekindled a lot of excitement for me. It was cool.
Yeah. Who's the guy that directed it? Favreau?
Yeah, Jon Favreau.
Okay. He did a phenomenal. I think he did the best.
Amazing.
He did the best job aside from obviously the original that I can think of.
Sure.
I think all the ones that they've done. Yeah. Since the original trilogy.
Any Star Wars fan now, you're just a hater if you didn't like that series.
Yes.
That's where I'm going to put that statement out there.
Yeah, he did a phenomenal job.
It was great.
And what'd you guys think of the CGI on Luke's face?
You know, it was passable. I think they tried that too with in Rogue One with you had Leia and then you also had the other general. And it was kind of like, it was passable. And I think he was a little bit, you know, better, but it's still like you could tell, you know, obviously.
It's still pretty good. Dude.
It wasn't bad.
I think it's really good.
It wasn't bad.
Yeah, I think it's way passable.
Yeah.
I mean, there's all kinds of fake stuff going on anyway, so it's not like that's like a big deal. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. If that was like the whole movie was like very realistic and then it was like this one fake thing, it would be a big turnoff. But since there's a lot of stuff that happens.
Dude, just goes to show you the power of that franchise. The Disney Plus or Disney, the company, the stock is taking off completely based off of the Star Wars spinoffs.
Of course.
Like, they have nothing else. Like, I own, I'm on Disney Plus. Like, okay, great.
How many shows did they just announce? They announced at least five or six that I can think of.
Well, do you remember the article that I shared earlier this year? I think it was earlier this year. Maybe it was even last year. That Disney was going at a different approach than, like, Netflix. Mm. So they're sticking with this. I mean, it's a very slow approach, right? Mm-hmm. They've only got this one main
character
series.
Development.
Yeah, they only exactly character development. One time a week they're releasing. They're not pumping out series. Netflix is the opposite.
Yeah,
like you can't go on Netflix.
So here's
anymore.
The kitchen sink.
Yeah, new stuff, new stuff, new stuff. And my best friends and I, we were talking this weekend actually, and one of my buddies had just said something. He's like, you know what? I think I'm gonna stop Netflix. He's like, they just lost it for me. He's all. I feel like they came out the gates really strong, and then it's just kind of fallen off.
He's it's like Stranger Things was amazing, but it's like when you get it all at once, you don't watch it, slowly. You just consume the
list. I know. Think about that, like a series like that was super popular. What would have happened had they drip that over time versus?
I think it would have made it even more popular.
Well, if you drip it, you don't need to provide so much new stuff,
uh-huh.
right? So Disney can stretch.
It's a hook.
Yes.
You know? Yeah.
Because think about how many people do you think signed up for Disney Plus
just for Mandalorian?
Just for Mandalorian.
Mm-hmm. A lot.
Now, if they dropped it all day one, they would have lost hella people because they've been waiting this whole time.
Right, right. You binge it and then you cancel your service next week.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Really. I think it's smart. Yeah, I think it's really, really smart what they're doing, and they exceeded their numbers. That's why the stock went up like crazy, because the whatever their projections were for Q4, they're crushing.
Now you brought up a show on Netflix off air, and I was gonna watch it with Jessica. Here's a funny Song Explorer.
Song Explorer.
I was gonna watch it with Jessica. You had mentioned what's her name now? I can't remember now.
Oh yeah, Dua Lipa.
Dua Lipa. So I'm scrolling through, and we're trying to figure out what to watch. It's late last night, and I'm Justin talked about this, and I'm like, oh. He said Dua Lipa was a good one. And of course, she accuses me. She's like, oh, just because it's a pretty girl. I'm like, no. I'm like, Justin said it was good.
No, it wasn't the reason.
She's like, yeah, right. That's why. She's like, he doesn't like pop music. I'm like, that's what I said to him.
And no, I
got in this whole thing. I'm like, forget it.
I missed this conversation. What was this?
No, I like artists. I like people that are really good at their craft. So it doesn't matter what genre of music it is. As long as they're like artistic about their presentation. It's not just some like formula that's carbon copied. And like, there's a ton of that out there. Yeah. So I totally appreciate her music.
We didn't watch it because it turned into that thing. I'm like, forget it. I'll watch it. So I'm like, all right. Yeah. She's like, just be honest about why you want to watch this. I'm like, I swear to God, Justin told me it was good.
Yeah. No, it's good. They break down their massive hit songs. So I also watched one with Trent Reznor, and he went through like Hurt and like how the state of mind he was in, like all this kind of stuff that played into like how haunting that song was, and like how he tracked it and how everything was just a little bit off, and what kind of instruments he used. And the guy's a genius, man. It's really cool to watch him.
I totally
break it down.
Missed this conversation. Who are we talking about?
So essentially
about?
It's a
who is it?
Dua Lipa is a pop star.
She's a pop
from
singer.
The UK. She's actually got some music that's pretty popular here too. But
okay.
Apparently the show, from what you told me, Justin, correct me if I'm wrong, it goes in kind of the process that these artists go through to create their
music.
Creative
process.
Okay.
And why I brought it up to Sal is I've never heard of her, and she has like millions of I don't know if it was like 60 something million followers or whatever. And I'm like, who is this? I'm always baffled at people
I did hear you say that.
Yeah, have that many people that know about them. I've never even heard of them. Yeah. You know, like it's always trippy to me.
Yeah. So anyway, you hear that, honey? We'll watch the episode.
Okay. I mean, she's cute.
So
she's
what ended up happening? He was like, oh, another night of Magic Mike?
Exactly. I'm like, come on, babe. You know what it was?
Yeah, that's right. You know what? Compromise,
no,
bro.
No, no, no. You know what happened? This is what happened. Now I've ruined it. It's because of that stupid-ass Keanu Reeves movie that I put on.
Oh, you still, yeah.
That's why. Because I put that on, and as it starts, it's basically soft
porn. You gotta dig yourself out of
porn, and I'm like sticking with it because I don't want to
Which one is that one?
The one I told you guys about. Remember the one where
the girls like show up? Up and, all wet from outside.
Yeah. She's like, I know why you want to
come
watch
in.
This. Yeah. So now no matter what, if there's a semi-attractive girl, she's like, oh, you just want to watch her for this. Yeah. I'm like, no, that was I totally screwed up last time.
Hey, I wanted to ask you if you read the article that Sean Baker shared on the Blue Zones.
Oh, I did.
The title caught me, and I wanted to hear your take on it.
I did. This is actually kind of interesting. So it's an interesting take. So there, he's basically painting a little doubt to the Blue Zone study. So so people who don't know, the Blue Zones are areas in the world where a disproportionate amount of people live to 100 or older in comparison to the rest of the world. And then what scientists do is they go into these Blue Zones and study how these people live and what is it that makes them live so long.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, what's the deal? What's going on? So he points to some interesting observations, which are kind of true. For example, in Italy, when they started to give people pensions based off of your age, and back in the day in Italy, you didn't have like birth certificates and stuff. So you could basically say, I was born in this year. When they started doing that, a lot of people started to say that they were older than they were to collect pensions. And so you have a lot of people who apparently are over 105 but might not be. And this was true.
Wow, interesting.
And this was true for a lot of other areas. Now,
do you know this firsthand because your family's told you stories, or did you read all this?
I read this, but this is also true. So, like my dad, for example, born at home, his birth certificate says he was born a few days later, because that's when they went and told the authorities or whatever. So it's not like it wasn't as accurate. And that's my dad's generation. When you go back, my grandfather's generation or before, it was basically when were you born, and they'll take your word for it, you know, type of deal.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So it is kind of interesting, because it does show in that when once that they were like official birth certificates, you see this huge drop off in how many people. Yeah. This was true for
Sardinia. And then
there's this place,
Okinawa.
Okinawa, and then there was another. There was like an island off the coast of Greece,
and they were all doing the same thing.
They're showing kind of similarities with this, and you know, I could see the case for that. I know when they're looking at like the oldest person in the world, that they have to try and verify it, and it's not like it would be like, for example, someone born today, if they live to 120, it'd be easy to verify. Somebody who's 120 today, especially from those areas, it would be difficult to verify. Oh, wow. You got to kind of look at different, you know, and kind of trust a little bit of what they're saying, and then you kind of make the judgment. So it's interesting. It is real interesting. And you were showing that a lot of these areas are poor, a lot of high smoking, a lot of high alcohol consumption, which normally would reduce, how long people live. So
how much did the drop off look like? Like, so when we look at today's time in those blue zones, is it dramatic? Or, I mean, what's the difference? Is it all of a sudden normal?
Well, I mean, if you look at like right now, life expectancy is a little bit higher in places like
Okinawa. But that's everywhere, isn't it? Everywhere we are expected to live a little bit longer, right?
Well, a little longer compared to like America, for example. But it's not a ton, right? It's not a ton longer. I will say this. This is interesting, though. Life expectancy still is a little higher in some of these countries that smoke more than we do here in America, but I think our diet's so bad here that it offsets that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's less smoking, but shitty ass diet.
Well, and don't you think that some other countries like prioritize relationships and breaks and time like off and stuff like that more than we do too?
Totally. Yeah, yeah, I think even in the blue zone studies, they didn't find any like silver bullets. You know what I mean? It wasn't like, oh, everybody eats this one food
which is what they're hoping to find.
Yeah. What they found was like they didn't overeat, or they ate, you know, mostly natural foods, and they were active every day, and they had close relationships. There wasn't any like big, you know, smoking gun. Like, this is what they all have in common. I mean, for example, in some areas they ate a lot of fish. In other areas they live in mountainous regions and they eat a lot of lamb and, you know, and goat milk. So, you know, which I believe that to be true. I don't think it's as easy as saying, do this specific thing and live a long time. I think it's a combination of kind of general things.
Do you have a prediction on like our generation now? I mean, the things that we have as far as like tools and hacks now that we like just 2 decades ago, generations didn't have. I'm really curious to like what that looks like.
Yeah. I think if I had to guess, you're seeing life expectancy increase, but quality of life, I think, is in a drop. Mm. So in other words, medication and, you know, modern medicine is going to extend life, but the quality of life isn't going to be that great. It's like we're keeping them alive with medicines, but they don't feel vibrant or good. You know,
do you think there's been a drop off of people getting into fitness and really taking care of their exercise? Like, I'm not sure. Like, what I see out there is a lot less people exercising.
Yeah, I think what I would like to see. I would like to see a study, because remember, when they look at the whole population, it's everybody.
Right. Yeah.
What I would like to see is a study on, because there are people over 70 that are consistent with diet, consistent with exercise. I trained a lot of them. I know these people, right? And they were so different from their peers. Like, the 70-year-olds that I knew that exercised regularly and ate right were like, they were like a different species compared to the average 7-year-old. They were very independent.
Yeah.
They were still having sex with their partners. They were healthy, no problems. And then the average 7-year-old's on like 15 different medications, you know, health problems. Yeah.
I'm just thinking of like your average guy, like I'll see just like walking around or at like coffee shops or whatever. Like I just don't see anybody really like that interested in lifting weights.
Yeah. You think it's less today?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah, totally.
Oh, I think it's more.
Yeah.
I think it's more.
I would hope so, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's still a low percentage. It's less than half still, you know what I'm saying? You're more likely to walk into a coffee shop or, you know, I think that matters too, like what you're walking into, right? Compared to walking in a coffee shop. Or a Walmart, you know, versus walking somewhere like Whole Foods. Walk into Whole Foods and you look around the grocery store and, you know, people look a lot fitter because they care, right? They're spending that extra money to eat, make better choices.
I think you see more people consciously working out today, but overall less active because activity used to be just a part of life before, you know what I mean?
Yeah, so it's just wrapped in everything.
Yeah, I remember telling my uncles, like I'd be like, why don't you guys work out? And they're like, I work out every day at work. I lift shit and move shit all day long at work. So I think it's just sedentary life. And then the way we design cities, like if you look at like old cities that were designed before cars got popular, you know, San Francisco, New York City, that kind of, people walk a lot. They're not designed like suburb. Like then they started designing like, suburbs and stuff like that. It's like houses here, work way over here. You have to drive everywhere. Yeah. You're not going to be walking that much. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, yeah. So I think that made a huge difference.
Did you guys see the North Korea article that I sent over about the guy that was publicly executed for listening to like radio from some other country?
That's insane.
Isn't that crazy?
That's insane.
Yeah, there you go. Wow. We don't realize how blessed we are that we get to do shit like that.
That's wild.
Yeah, I know. It's just because he was listening to the radio.
Dude, publicly. That kind of control over the population. That's so scary.
It's insane. It's insane.
How hard is it for somebody to actually leave there? If you were born there, how hard is it to leave?
People escape and they cross over to South Korea or they'll go through China or whatever. And you should hear the story. Have you guys ever watched like YouTube videos of interviews of these people?
No, I should.
Oh, it is insane. There was this one lady who escaped North Korea. They brainwash you so much as a kid there that when she left, she still thought that the North Korean leader could read her mind. Mm-hmm. So she was afraid to say anything. She was afraid to whatever. She thought that when she went to South Korea, she was worried that they were going to kill her and eat her because that's what she was told.
Oh, my God.
And yeah. And she says that when she came over there, she saw the world and was just – she didn't believe it. She didn't believe it for years. She was so in shock.
It just shows you what could happen when you give somebody absolute power like that.
I know. It's pretty crazy.
That would do some serious damage.
Yeah. How was your guys' weekend, by the way?
Good.
Did you guys do anything?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you were the one I wanted to talk to because you went up to Sanctuary.
Oh, so nice.
Yeah. Tell me how that was.
Oh, first night away, right?
First time with Aurelius out there?
With Aurelius.
Yeah, we took the baby and it was great, man. We hung out because the beach is right there and got some time with my wife, so that was real nice. He actually slept a little bit, so we got to do a little hanky-panky, which is
good. Yeah, that's nice. Yeah, I saw the photo of you guys in your robes on the beach and stuff like that. So did you sleep with the door open? Did you do that?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
The fire, and then you hear the water out there.
Yeah, dude.
You know they were doing outdoor yoga classes over there?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah,
that was cool.
Yeah, I was like, all right, they're still doing the thing or whatever.
Yeah,
that's
good.
No, we had a good time, man. It's I think that's important to do. Because we're not like doing a lot, but just because it changes the environment, it's nice to get that reprieve.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, totally.
What about you, Justin? What did you guys do?
I did a lot of housework. The kids and Courtney had been gone like all weekend.
Oh, that's right. I forgot they're down south, huh?
Yeah, they were gone and then they came back. And so we just...
You've been awfully quiet for a guy who's been home alone by himself all last week and stuff. What you been up to, guy?
I've been chilling, dude.
Huh?
I'm taking advantage of it, you know?
Like, yeah, like three Jergens bottles by now?
Just a lot. Just a lot of that. A lot of Kleenex, you know, just flying everywhere.
Buy stock now, guys.
You look so relaxed. I was like, this face is so relaxed.
Yeah. I feel drained, I'm going to be honest. But I've just been enjoying it, man. And
we see
walking
that.
The dogs, you know, I'm just doing things on my speed.
Watching all the ancient aliens you want.
Yeah, ancient, like old, like shitty 80s movies, you know, that's always a go-to for me. And like stand-up comedy is my favorite, which, you know, Courtney always gets are we going to watch another one? Like it's all, you know, so I'm just all in, you know, I get to watch whatever I want.
Dude, speaking of the dogs, bro, last night, I fucking, my heart broke, dude. I So my boys, right, Mozzie and Bentley are like, they were my first kids, right? So they were the first dogs that I ever bought and raised and everything. And so before Max, they were like my children. You guys mm-hmm. know that. I'd bring them in here all the time. And they're stubborn as shit. That's just part of the breed. You get that. And they're like little bricks, dude, right? So like when they act up sometimes, they'll give them like a little kick in the ass and shit, right? And Katrina's like, oh, don't kick the dog. I'm like, I'm barely kicking the dog. He's freaking solid as can be. Trust me. He'll let you know if you hurt him or what like that. And he doesn't even yelp. So I took them both out last night. And Mozzie was just acting a fool. He's grabbing his leash and riding in. He's wrapping around me and stuff like that. And he tangles around my leg. And I give him like this little side kick. I don't even kick him hard at all. But I hit his leg. It was like in a bad position. And he did this yelp and scream that I've never heard before. Oh. And he couldn't put weight on it. I scooped him up. I carried him in the house. Bro, I was like, just talking about it gets me emotional.
You felt like the biggest
dude. And Katrina, terrible. This is how bad it was. So Katrina was up putting Max to sleep. Mind you, we run Brain FM in there, so you can't hear anything out of his bedroom. So Katrina's in there. You can't hear outside normally. And she comes downstairs because she could hear the screaming, hear Mozzie screaming outside. And I'm carried in. She's like, what happened? What's going on? And I'm like, I kicked him. And she's like, what? And I'm like, hon, I swear I didn't kick him that hard. I was just trying to get him to stop doing what he was doing. And I gave him this little side thing, but it was the way his leg was. And dude, I'm so glad this morning he woke up and he was walking on.
Yeah, he's fine.
Oh, he's fine now. But last night he couldn't put weight on it. He screamed like,
bro, you felt like the biggest piece of shit,
God, bro. It's hard for me to share it too because I know there's gonna be a bunch of people that think I beat my dog and stuff. I was like, I'm not like that guy at all.
You just wait till the first day you like yell at your kid or something.
Oh man, you know that's what went through my head, right? Like that's exact. I went through my head because I think of them like my children, and I thought, oh my God, I would just be devastated if I wasn't a hard hit at all. It wasn't like, I wasn't even that angry. I was just frustrated because he was tangling my leg up and I was trying to get him off and just kind of gave him a little,
gave him like a Charlie horse.
Yeah, dude, but it was just the angle of his leg and stuff, and it hurt him so bad that he screamed like that. I never heard that. Oh my God.
Yeah. I could tell when I saw him too. He looked at me like, save me.
Yeah, he's like, dude, get me away from this monster.
Yeah. Like, get me away from him.
So like, it's bad.
I was petting him like, it's all right.
Yeah, it's all right. You know, dude, it's people terrible. That still love you.
Your dad's
now I'm all afraid. Abusive. Yeah. I know it's like, dude, I was so, right away too, I'm like, I scooped him up. I'm like, oh my God, if any neighbor like saw me like do that.
You're like hand feeding him now.
Oh, yeah. Dude. Yeah.
He's like a king now. Yeah. Come here, buddy. Yeah.
He's going to take full advantage.
You get whatever you want, buddy.
I'm sure. Uh-huh. I'm sure.
Dude, you just wait till the first time you like yell at your kid because you're human, you know, and you get these little whatever. I remember the first, when I yelled at my son once when he was little and he made this like terrified look in his face. I mean, and I felt like the biggest piece of shit of all time. I still do. Talking about it, I still feel like a massive piece of shit.
Yeah.
He made this look like, huh? And I was like,
what?
Wow.
What is all this?
Yeah, I'm the worst dad of all time.
Oh, when they look at it, big eyes, and then it takes a minute, and then it starts like tears, and they're like, oh, no. Wait.
What have I
done? Let me take it back.
Dude, speaking of eyes, I didn't tell you guys about this. Oh, my God, dude. So when I get off the freeway to come, this happened on last week. I've been saving the story. So when I get off the freeway to come over here, when I come off, there's always one or two homeless people on the end there of the off-ramp because they get money, right? So people stop at the light and they get money.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was this – I didn't recognize this homeless person, and they were there, and they were standing there with the sign or whatever. And the dude's eyes pointed in two different directions, so they're like doing this type of thing.
Not cross-eyed, but the opposite?
No, opposite. Like he's like a lizard.
Like this is like an Adam Sandler movie.
Yeah, so he's like this way, right? And so – I was like, I was kind of feeling like it's the holiday season, you know, and every once in a while, if I have spare money, I'll give it to him. So I'm like, you know what? I'm going to give this guy, you know, he's looking at me, or I think he is. I don't know. I can't tell. He's kind of staring this way. So I can't tell. Right. So I'm like, I'm going to help him out. So I roll my window down and he gives me this heads up and he starts walking and I'm like, took out my money. And he went to the car behind me, got money. I was like, he wasn't looking at me. I had my hand out with the money like this, dude.
I'm over here.
He just walked by, went to someone else and walked back. I was like, light turned green. I drove off. I felt like I got rejected, dude. It's like, fuck you then. You don't get my money, man.
I drove by a guy yesterday that had a literally like full on like stylish like camo fitted, like from head to toe. Like,
how'd you see him?
Yeah, cool camouflage, right? Talking on a cell phone, holding up a sign.
Really?
Yeah, dude. I just that's the new homeless, bro. Have cell phones now.
Well, that's they're just shows you how cheap.
I thought I heard. Wasn't it one of you guys that told me that they have some sort of a deal where you can come in and get like a free cell phone?
Can you?
Someone told me that.
I didn't get no free phone.
Yeah. Well, no, you're not homeless. That's why.
Cricket Wireless.
It's not homeless. It's a minimalist.
Is that, oh yeah, what is yeah,
extreme minimalist?
Is that what it is?
Yeah, I think that's what it is. Dude, I read a study on sleep deprivation. I forgot to bring this up. You guys want to hear something crazy?
Let's hear it.
So on people who sleep 6 hours or less a night, so these are people with pretty bad sleep, right? They had a 32% gain in visceral fat.
Oh, wow.
32%. That's cute. You know, visceral fat, right, for the listeners.
And is that because of the cortisol spike? Is that what it is?
You know, they didn't go into, you know, all the reasons why. I would assume it's the hormones that are being thrown off, and I would, and the inflammation. Inflammation has been tied to visceral fat. But I would also assume that having that shitty sleep might mean you probably eat more to self-medicate.
Oh, we talked about this like 6 months ago where we and I didn't connect this until not that long ago, that when I have a really shitty night of sleep, the next day the food cravings I have are crazy. Like I want greasy, bad, like junk food. That's all I want to eat, and it's really tough to not after you've had that terrible night of sleep.
Wow, that's interesting. So somebody DM'd me and said, and I said no. I said no, but I'm going to think back. I'm going to think now that maybe there's something to it. Somebody messaged me and said that they got the Felix Gray blue blocker glasses, and they said that they're noticing that they're getting leaner. Is this because I'm getting better sleep? Mm. And I said, no, it's probably something you're not tracking or whatever, your diet. But I wonder, right? I wonder if, because you're right, when you lack sleep, you crave foods that are comforting to make you feel better.
It depends how long you've been running on poor sleep too, you know, like it, and this is maybe something you're introducing that, you know, for a week to a month, all of a sudden now has pretty substantial power behind it.
Yeah. So I wonder if that would, I know for me, if I don't notice fat gain, but if I get bad sleep, I don't build muscle and perform as well. That's
But what about the cravings though? Do you guys notice that? Have you ever? I never really paid attention to it.
Yeah, I crave sweets.
And I thought you shared. I could have sworn it was you who shared an article. Sal.
I did.
A while back.
Yeah, hyperpalatable food. So starches, sugars, and and processed foods. The consumption increases.
Yeah.
Because of the production of the feel good chemical. You know, if you lack sleep, right? You've got less of these feel good chemicals. You're probably more likely to do things like drink alcohol, coffee, smoke cigarettes too, right? Mm-hmm. Everything that makes you kind of, you know, feel good in the moment.
Yeah, yeah.
But I mean, shit, man, that's a big one.
It could totally add up. I could totally see
that. And visceral body fat's the one that's connected to really poor outcomes. And
32% is a lot.
Yeah.
That's a lot, dude. That's the fat around your organs. For people don't know, that's so when you see like the beer belly guy, whose belly, maybe you have someone like this in your family. This was my great uncle used to do this. He had this big beer belly. But he'd tell the kids to hit him and punch it. It's hard though. It's muscle.
Yeah.
He used to do that to us, right?
Right. Like it's all muscle.
Yeah. It's not fat. It's man. I remember as a kid being like, whoa, you know?
Yeah.
You know, our uncle's got
hard.
It's got a fat but muscular stomach. It's because it's underneath, dude.
Yep.
Yeah. And, you know, he's not around anymore.
Yeah.
So. Oh, man. I know. That's sad.
Bad joke. Story.
Yeah.
No, you know what I like is to see science out there that's making a difference, you know, and like things, big things people are tackling that actually work. One of them was these fog nets. I've never heard of this, but I guess they've figured out in a place, I think it was in Peru, where it's like pretty much a desert. They get like no rain, but they get the fog runoff from the ocean. And so they had this idea to create these big nets that basically it would capture the fog and turn it into usable drinking water.
Oh, so like condensation.
Yeah.
Oh, that's smart.
Yeah, what? Just like, I mean, that's pretty much what the redwood trees and all the trees do right around here. So, yeah, it's pretty fascinating that they've hacked that, and they get like thousands and thousands of gallons.
Oh, so paint this picture for me. So I'm envisioning like four drones that are flying like this massive net, and then they
They're just propped up nets, like literally like really thick fibrous nets, and it all traps it, and then it funnels it down into this barrel.
It's literally as it sounds. Look at this picture right here.
Yeah,
it's literally like it sounds. It's just nets that are out, and then because the fog goes through, and there's condensation on the fog, and then, I mean, excuse me, on the nets, and then it drips down.
Brilliant.
Yeah, I know, right?
Then they filter it, I imagine, and then now it's drinking water.
A cheap way to get water.
Yeah.
Wow.
A really, really cheap way to get water.
Wow, that is fascinating.
Very interesting. Hey, you guys want some bad news or some scary news?
Yeah.
Good. Yeah, let's offset that.
So did you guys hear the news out of the UK? You guys seeing this, what's going on right now?
No.
Apparently there's, and this, I don't know, some scientists are saying nothing to worry about. Other scientists are like, this is a big thing. Apparently there's a mutation of COVID in the UK that's making it like 70% faster or more transmissible. So all these countries in Europe are banning travel from the UK now because they've identified this new strain that is making COVID spread faster.
What?
And now what they're saying is that they think that they're saying for sure these vaccines will protect against
this. Dude, we're never going to be able to travel again. No. Like, I have pretty much concluded.
No, dude. It's going to be virtual travel.
How annoying.
What about what's going on, too? You sent over a thing that they're going to make. By the way, did you see they just passed, what was it, $800 billion? Was it $800 billion just got passed for the $600 checks or whatever?
Yay.
Yeah, I know.
Everybody gets $600.
I know.
$600.
$800 more billion dollars coming. Then I saw the article you shared about making loans easier to get. Boy, we are just going to inflate.
Just gonna keep pumping that bubble,
boy.
Dude, but how mad are you though?
A 2-bedroom condo over here is gonna be like $3 million for like 5 years.
You're
gonna be,
my lord!
What country was it where they inflated their currency so bad? Was it Zimbabwe? I don't remember. They inflated the currency so bad that people were like, it was more valuable to be burned for heat.
I was just gonna say. I mean, imagine
they had like $10 trillion notes.
Dude, it's headed in that direction.
The
I'm
people that
lie.
Should be the most pissed are the people that have been saving for like the last 20 years. Like
they just cut your value.
Yeah, busting your ass like to build your savings account up to a few $100,000 stuff like that.
Oh,
like,
so that just, dollar you have now is 25 cents.
20, yeah. Exactly.
Ugh.
No, I mean, on the flip side though, how mad are you if you're the average person? You're struggling because, I don't know, you own a restaurant and, you know, Emperor Newsom shut it down or whatever, and you're struggling. You're like, oh my God, we're not making. And then they're like, hey, I know it's been hard for the last year.
Bucks.
Yeah. Here's $600, my friend.
Here's some gas money.
Yeah. Don't spend it all in one place.
Meanwhile, my winery, you know, gets millions of dollars and, you know, really quick to support it.
Right.
Here's $600, buddy.
Yeah.
Take care of yourself.
Now that
high five.
Did you read the article on the? I think it's. I don't know if I'm saying if it's right. I don't know, Doug. Maybe fact check me. It's 600 or 800 billion is what got approved, right? So it's. And is that all just for the $600 stimulus checks?
I have no idea.
And how long do those last? I mean, for a couple months, maybe at best, and then they're gonna have to run it again.
Dude, what's $600 gonna do for
it's
people?
It's a great example of people that want the government to come save everybody.
Yeah,
yay, $600, good idea.
It makes me.
Well,
sad.
How long can we keep doing it? That's the question. It's like how many rounds of that? I mean, I shared with you guys that webinar from Peter Linneman that talked about that he predicted at least two more $2 trillion bailouts coming.
Yeah.
By the end of 2021.
I would think so. Yeah, there it is, $900 billion.
Oh, it was $900 billion. I thought it was six.
That's
or
what
eight.
It says. Long stimulus bill to provide $900 billion in aid. Well, I mean, at least it's something.
Like, yeah, at this point, that amount of money doesn't even make sense. You know, it's like $900 billion.
Here's
that's
what
so much money.
Here's what I don't think.
Soon we're gonna have to make up what comes after a trillion.
Quadzillion? Is that?
Yeah, soon we're going to have to make up a number.
A fuck ton.
Yeah.
Congress passes.
That's going to be a real, it's a real allotted amount of money.
Congress passes two fuck tons of money to help everybody.
It weighs a lot.
Here's what I don't understand. Instead of printing a bunch of money, what if they just said, hey, everybody, let's not pay taxes this year.
Right. Can we do that instead?
I don't know why they don't
do
that.
Why don't they do that?
I don't know. I mean, they both.
It's too smart. They don't like smart ideas.
No, they'll give you the money so you can give it back.
Dumb ideas are best.
Yeah. I don't know. We'll see what happens. It's going to be quite interesting because, you know, all these assets, you're going to see a lot of asset inflation, stock market, houses.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They're going to keep inflating because more and more free money is
Are you following Tesla? I know. I can't believe that thing just keeps going up and now it's on the S&P 500.
Oh, well, speaking of which, because you know how Elon.
When are those trucks coming out, man?
Oh, the Cybertruck?
Yeah.
I like that.
There's lots of hype around that. I haven't seen
You guys still think it's ugly? You don't like it?
Yes,
still?
It's ugly.
Yeah, dude. It's hideous.
Really?
Yeah.
They've made some other really cool electric
ones. Moon vehicle.
Since then.
That's why it's cool.
You've seen, what's the Nikola, that other company?
Oh, yeah.
Their truck, their electric truck looks sick.
Does it?
Well, yeah. I heard they were like garbage. Actually in some heat because they were trying to partner with GM is what, okay, I read this. I'm not, fact check me, Doug, but I read something like that whole deal went fell through because of their falsifying of numbers or something like that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Like as far as like the power of it and everything like that?
Yeah, well, like what they're projecting its value.
I can't believe shit anymore.
I know.
Everything's fake news.
Hey, speaking of Tesla.
I know.
You know, Elon moved to Texas, right? So that sparked this whole conversation.
Yeah.
So for the first time in a long time, California is likely to lose an electoral vote. And I believe a seat in Congress because our population is shrinking.
I heard you say this. Now, I want to fact check that, Doug. We all have fact checking.
I know. Move those fingers.
Yeah, look up California lose electoral vote.
Well, look that up. Look up our population because I thought that even though everyone's talking about this like mass exodus of California, right? Everyone's leaving California, that we still year over year gain people. Gain more than we lose. No, that's what I thought.
Really? We're at a loss. We're at a net loss right now.
Come on, give me the numbers. I want to hear how much.
Yeah.
Like five people? That's not very much.
No, dude. I think it's 130 here. Oh, this is weird. State officials say California's population growth has slowed to the lowest rate on record. For the second year in a row, more people left the state than moved there. The result was a net migration loss of 135,600 people.
Oh wow! So two years in a row now, first time in the history of California.
They've been losing it for a long time, and this is the biggest loss in 25 years that we've seen.
But what you just read was that only these last 2 years has there been a true net loss. It's always, even though we're losing people, we still have always been gaining more than we're losing until the last 2 years.
I don't know. I think we've been losing few years.
Doug's got it up here. Hold on. Yeah. Officially, California had 21,000 people from July 1st, 2019, increasing this. See? See? You're wrong,
but
Sal.
Hold on.
You're wrong.
Increasing by 0.05%. No.
However, it's changed recently.
Okay. See,
but the bigger news from Wednesday's new population estimate was that, like I said, 135,600 more people, 135,000 more people left the state than moved here. So people are still moving here. It's just more people are leaving.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
If I'm hearing what you're reading correctly, the first time in 2 years, the last 2 years have been actually net losses. Up until that point, all the people that we were losing 5 years ago, we were still gaining more.
So we're losing seats now? Is that what you're saying?
We're likely to lose an electoral vote and, I believe, a seat in Congress, if I'm not mistaken. Hmm. So that will reduce.
Does that happen often? How often does that happen?
Not for California.
I mean, for any state.
I wonder if that's the same too in New York right now. I heard that they're having a mass exodus.
They're losing quite a bit in New York as well. So, and in a lot of, I know a lot of Californians are going to Texas. So I'm wondering if Texas will gain, you know, a vote and I don't even know what the numbers are for that. Like, how do they determine?
Yeah, like exactly how many people have to be in there, leave or come in order to add another vote.
Yeah. It's interesting though, right? So, you know, this is, I tell you what, a little bit of the brilliance in the way that our government was designed. It was designed so that states have quite a bit of power in how they can run things. And the reason why this is a good thing is it shows you what works and what doesn't work. And the best way to tell is where are people living? Where are they moving?
Mm-hmm.
Who's losing places? And, you know, California losing a lot of people.
Doing a bad job with leadership.
Exactly.
Look at that first one Doug just pulled up right now. 17 states that will gain or lose electoral college votes in 2020.
Wow. Oh, okay. So there's going to be other ones too. Interesting, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, California's been in trouble for a little while. It's really, for people who don't know, who've never been here, it's the have and the have-nots. That's what California is. You have the Bay Area and the coast, and then everywhere else, it's very different. It's like two different states completely. Like you drive into mid-California versus like LA.
Central Valley
is
completely different.
Totally different.
Weren't they trying to separate us at one point? Were they trying to make us into two?
Oh yeah, there was
right?
that.
Like, yeah, there was south the thing? South. South California. Yeah.
No, there was like three or four Californias, weren't there?
Oh, was that?
That's right. Because the Bay Area was.
You're
just,
right. There was like north, south, and then central.
Yeah, there was like the weed part of California. It's just the north, the tech part.
To make that
we're
cut.
Green government. Yeah,
the movie part, you know, and then the farmer part, you know.
Totally.
That's kind of what it is.
That's funny.
Our first question is from Beauty and Gains Coach. What are the pros and cons of circuit training, and when and how should it be incorporated into one's training program?
All right, this is a good question. Circuit training is quite popular, mainly because of the intensity, the calorie burn. It's short, so it can be pretty convenient. Here's the deal, though. It has to be done properly. Circuit training with exercises haphazardly put together, especially when they incorporate plyometric stuff into circuit training or just stuff to make you tired. You're essentially just doing high intensity cardio. You know, there's no reason to even do exercises. You might as well do jumping jacks and burpees. You'll get the same result. So if a circuit training program is planned and programmed well, it is a great way to get a workout in a short period of time. It's good for stamina, endurance, and occasionally might even provide a little bit of muscle stimulation. Maybe not if you're advanced, but if you're like beginner or intermediate, you might get some strength gains. The way to program it, I think you should do short cycles of it. I really do. I think, you know, circuit training is done best 3 weeks and then go back to your standard, you know, weight training.
I think either like that or just intermittently thrown in there when you absolutely need a short workout. Yeah. Because of the research that came out around HIIT, like I want to say, was that 2001, 2002,
right
around there when it got really popular. Then it turned into this like mainstream thing. Like everybody started training this way because of the research of how many calories and how much fat you can burn and how it kicks that up for the entire day. Your body burns X amount more calories. And the truth is that it's a terrible way to build muscle. It is not the best way to build muscle. Straight strength training is far better than that. Typical standard programming where you phase in and out of like cycles is a much better approach to your weightlifting journey. But the reality is there are times when you only have 20 minutes. And to me, that's when it makes sense to use a tool like this, is you use it intermittently when you only have that. And if you're somebody who's listening and you only always have 20 minutes, then okay, then that makes sense, right, to train this way. But the rest of the population that has the option of training for 50 minutes or for a 20-minute circuit, you're far better off training the 50-minute straight set type of strength training cycle majority of the time and then intermittently either one running it like Sal's saying for a 2-week, 4-week short cycle then you get out of it or just using it when you have to, when you can only get 20 minutes in.
Yeah, a lot of those studies, they used like a stationary bike and that was like, because it was controlled and, you know, there's less impact and they could really ramp up the intensity. So with HIIT, it's really about ramping up your intensity and it is cardiovascular on some level. So, you know, in terms of me personally, I prefer to do a HIIT style workout if I'm going to do cardio so I could throw in a lot of different movements if I want to maintain a lot of athleticism and be able to, you know, move through all the different planes, but, you know, maybe add some load. But yeah, it's intense. So it needs to be done in short spurts and you need to be able to perform it with good form throughout. Otherwise, you know, you're going to start having diminishing returns, and especially if you're teaching your body poor technique.
What a great point there. If your form is this, that's the biggest problem with circuit training is form. The form goes out the window because it's a fatigue-based workout. This was one of my biggest gripes with CrossFit back in the day is that they turned everything into a circuit. And when you do that, your technique, inevitably, it's going to go south. It just does. Like anytime you're super fatigued, even if you're doing an exercise you're very, very proficient at, your technique goes out the window and then you start to train bad movement patterns in your body.
Yeah.
Injury rate goes through the roof and you lose the value of the exercise. And then it doesn't become important what exercise you do anymore.
And this is my biggest gripe because there's a definitive line between training and competing. And when you blur all that together, you lose both the benefits. So, you know, like just keep that in mind. Like when you're training, you want to be conscious of always trying to perfect form and keep composure.
Next question is from Amy in a rarity. With consistent use of MAPS anabolic, how long should it take a dedicated person to lose between 75 to 100 pounds of fat?
Oh, with MAPS anabolic, you're looking at 30 days probably. You know,
we would have sold a lot more programs. Yeah, we picked,
you know,
some
what?
Fun.
Yeah. Could you lose 75 to 100 pounds in a year?
That's a 2-year goal, right there.
I was just gonna say,
that's a 2-year goal.
If you did it in a year, you probably did it too fast.
Too fast.
Yeah, you're looking at a 2-year process. And the reason why I'm saying that, it's not just physiologically why you should do it slower. There's a benefit there also. But also psychologically, the change, if you're 100 pounds overweight, there are some major lifestyle changes that need to happen in order to get you to not just to lose 100 pounds, but then to keep the weight off. And those changes are not easy, okay? You might be able to, they might look simple. So you might look at a piece of paper and write them down and say, oh, I went from being totally sedentary. I'll just need to be active every day. And I was eating 5,000 calories a day. I'm just gonna eat 2,000 or 1,500 calories a day. And then I'll lose the weight. Well, that's true. But if you don't make lifestyle changes permanent, which is a long process, you will end up a statistic. And statistically speaking, people who lose a lot of weight, 90% of the time or more, gain it back and then some. So this, if this is you and you're got, and you have to lose this much weight, I would give you 2 to 5 years is what I would say. I would in fact, I wouldn't even think of it that way. The way I would think of it is I'm going to make small changes, stick with them, and slowly change my lifestyle. And the weight loss will happen as a side effect. Is how that's how I would do
it. Yeah, and whoever is asking this question, I'm sure that's not the answer you're looking for. You probably want to hear that it'd be faster. But here's the exciting part about this is you can actually only lose 25 to 50 pounds on the scale this year, you know, or in the next year, and completely make your body look different. So, I mean, a number like 100 pounds of fat is like this arbitrary number that like most people go, oh, I'm 250 or 300 or 350. I have to get off X amount off of you. But your body will look completely different if you do this correctly and still only lose 25 or 50 on the scale. If you have, you know, built in a good training program, you're dieting well, you're eating well, you're not starving your body, you're not running up your calorie expenditure like crazy, just trying to drop pounds as fast as you can, and you're actually trying to make these lifestyle changes that Sal's talking about, you can look completely different, 25 or 50 pounds different on the scale, because if you've done it right, you'll have built muscle along the way while also burning body fat versus somebody who just does the route that Sal is saying, which is, okay, can I do 100 pounds in a year? Yes, you can. I mean, dramatically cut your calories in half, run like crazy, just move every single day. I mean, you could lose that weight. The problem is, you're going to lose a ton of body fat along the way, and you're also going to lose a bunch of muscle along the way, and your body composition is not going to be that much better than had you done it slow and controlled.
And you'll also gain it back because, okay, you got to understand something. When I say big lifestyle changes, your lifestyle is a part of who you are, okay, how you live. So imagine living in a way that's completely different from the way you live now, in a way that requires new discipline, new structure, and you're taking away some of your favorite ways to self-medicate, whether it's for boredom, stress, anxiety, whatever. You're removing that. You're removing your favorite drug, which is to medicate with food. You're adding in new activities, totally different lifestyle, which means you're probably going to hang out with people differently. You're probably going to do different things. That is a major change. To change that overnight and then to keep it permanent, almost impossible.
Yeah,
it's a slow process.
It's much more of a takeaway and punishment driver that's going to get you there quicker. I look at it like this. Like if I had a Scantron and I'm going through this test and I just memorized all the answers and then I got there and I was able to pass the test and, you know, I got there, but then you go back and did you learn anything? You didn't really learn anything.
Right.
You need to go through all the hard steps to really understand, you know, what's happening with your body and why you're driven to eat certain kinds of foods, when that happens, what kind of stressful situation triggers certain things. Things like what kind of sleep you need to get, like all of these factors matter for you going forward so it lasts.
And also having compassion for yourself.
Totally.
You know, one of the things that's really tough when you get someone this, they want to go in and they want to beat themselves up like crazy, reduce the calories.
Well, they've had a realization. Oh my God, look what I did to myself.
Right. You know? And so somebody that comes to me with this goal, I normally actually tell them, I don't want to lose any weight at first. And they hate to hear that from me, but it's like, I want to build these good behaviors. I want to build your metabolism. I want to start to do things with you that's going to last you for the rest of your life. And if all you cared about was weight, yeah, I could give you the answers to the test. Like Justin said, just cut your calories in half, get in here, move twice as much, and you're going to lose body fat. You're going to lose weight. It's going to come off of you. But you know, my goal for you is to change your behaviors, to change your life forever. And that's actually a slow and gradual process. And you don't want to, and this doesn't matter if you're trying to lose 100 pounds or 20 pounds. That first month to 6 months that I get somebody like this or that wants to lose anything, I don't want to lose at first. At first, I want to regain balance. I want to introduce foods that they should be eating more of into their diet versus going right into saying, hey, take away, cut.
Okay, so here's your strategy. And I've worked with quite a few people who've lost an excess of 70 pounds. And towards the end of my career, I actually had a lot of success. But here was how we did it. This is where we actually found success. This is, by the way, one of the hardest segments of the population to get permanent results or get long-lasting results. One of the most difficult when you're dealing with over 60 pounds of weight loss. It gets very, very hard. But here's the strategy that I used towards the end of my career that actually had a pretty good success rate. So what you want to do is you want to remember that the inner changes cause the outer changes. So we want to focus on working on the inside of you. And I don't mean physically. I mean just kind of working the inside, more from an esoteric standpoint, I guess. So do this. Hire yourself a trainer. That's real important. Now, that's for your exercise. And work with a trainer that has worked with people in your situation. Don't hire the boot camp trainer. Don't hire the extreme motivational trainer that's going to beat you up. Hire the trainer that's going to start you off slow, that's empathetic, that's actually telling you to slow down, not the one that's trying to kick you in the butt and trying to make you do crazy amounts of workouts. So that's number one. Number two, hire yourself a good therapist. The therapist is going to be someone you're going to work with on a weekly, if not bi-weekly basis, and you're going to be working with them for a long time. This therapist is going to be one of the most valuable people you have in your arsenal because, again, a lot of the changes you're making to your lifestyle are more than just changing your diet and becoming more active. It actually it's about root causes to the reasons why you've been living the way you have. So trainer, therapist, and if you throw a third person in there, then I would throw in somebody who's a nutrition expert. In my experience working with those people, when I've worked with clients like this, with the therapist, and especially if they had someone do nutrition, we had tremendous success, and it was permanent success. These are people that I haven't worked with for years. I still see on social media who've still been able to keep the weight off, and they still see a therapist on a relatively regular basis because, again, this is a hard thing to work with, but they did not go backwards and gain all that weight back.
Next question is from Emoy5. What do you think about gastric bypass or any surgical procedure to help lose weight?
Gastric bypass will make you lose weight, but it's not going to cure your problem.
Right.
So gastric bypass forces you to lose weight, okay, because they completely reconstruct your stomach, make it the size of a thumb. So you're literally physically forced to eat less. Unfortunately, it does not solve the root reason of why you were eating so much in the first place. Now, in some cases, I can see value. There's some emergency cases. Your health is so bad, they're like, we just need to do this, and then we'll worry about the other stuff afterwards. But it's not going to solve the root cause. Most, in my experience, the people I've worked with who've been, this is kind of connected to the previous question, right? The people that I've worked with who have to lose this much weight, because gastric bypass is usually for people who need to lose a tremendous amount of weight. In my experience, there's a lot of pain and suffering behind that. And what ends up happening when you remove their medication of choice, which was food, they're left now with struggle. Like, oh my God, how do I medicate this pain or this issue that I have? Some of them turn to drugs. Some of them turn to sex. Some of them turn to other addictions. Mm-hmm. So it'll make you lose weight, but it's not going to fix
I only see value in this when it is life or death.
Yeah.
If it's life or death, if you've got somebody, doctor says, listen, you've got, at the rate you're going, the weight you are, the conditions that you have, you're going to die in a year or two if you don't get this weight off. And so to me, I see that, right? And I've seen that. I've seen that plenty of times, and that makes sense. Then I've also seen people that have tried to gain weight so they could actually apply.
Oh my God, I saw that too.
And be approved for gastric bypass. Now that is insane to me. And I've actually had clients that have tried to hire me.
Yeah, they didn't qualify, so they had to gain weight.
Yes, they weren't overweight enough, and they want to get the gastric bypass. And so they've hired me to help them put weight on them before they go get it. And I just refuse to do that. So I think that for that reason. And then here's the other thing. So with liposuction, right? That would be the other surgery that you'd see. Again, almost everybody, it's like high, super high. Everybody puts body fat goes back up. And let me tell you, I've seen a lot of these bodies, obviously working in the gym for as long as we have, it looks weird. I mean, and I would challenge anybody that's actually seen these pictures of what people look like when they've done liposuction and they go back and they put 20 pounds or more of body fat on, and now that they've like artificially sucked it out of their body, different than the way it would come on or come off of your body, yeah. It now makes you look weird. Like I've seen people do like the
well, it's in other places now.
Yeah, I've seen people do these tummy tucks and they drop 20, 30 pounds from the tummy tuck, and then they still have the really flabby arms. Then they put the 20 pounds back on, and then it looks all disproportionate. It looks really, really weird, and you'd rather have them. I mean, I would rather just be overweight than to be all proportioned. Yeah,
there was actually a member of my gym that did that, got lipo on their trunk, actually consulted with me beforehand, and I tried to convince them to go the trainer route and the nutrition route. They said no.
Yeah.
They got a lot of body fat taken off their trunk. Anyway, months later, they started gaining the weight back. And what was really weird, they weren't gaining it around the trunk like they did before, but their face and their shoulders
they look all
were
weird.
Gaining body fat, it was like, oh my gosh, this looks really, really strange.
That's bizarre. Yeah, I mean, I haven't heard of actually gaining weight. That's crazy to me, leading in to get the surgery. Because I've seen, you know, there's at least some doctors out there that are like, well, you know, in order to even, do this surgery and put you under, you're going to need to lose this weight. And they have to, like, prove that they can lose weight for at least, like, a month and do, like, a regular, like, fitness routine like, you know, have some kind of discipline. So, I think if it depends on on the place, but also like the extreme kind of life or death situation is really the only place I see value.
Next question is from Haley Green Strong. What career do you have massive respect for but would never be able to do?
Oh, what would
can
I
we
have?
Say, can I say single mother here? Because that does that count? And I think
this is a single parent.
It's like single mother doing any job. Like literally, if you're all by yourself as a parent, I don't give a shit if you're a librarian or you sit at AM/PM fucking working all day. Like that, I don't care what the job is. If you're trying to manage making a living while also raising a child of yourself,
that's insane.
I couldn't do it. I know I would just fail miserably. I'd be a terrible dad, or I'd be broke as a joke and be a great dad. It'd be one or the other. I don't know if I could do both.
Yeah, Jessica has a friend who has a 3-year-old or 2-year-old and a new baby who's 3 months old.
Mm-hmm.
And she's a single mom and she works, takes care of both of them. And I'm just like, I don't know how you don't, burn out or die. Like, this is insane. What an incredibly difficult job. So aside from single parent, I think I volunteered to teach a kindergarten class and talk to them.
Did you really?
I did. So I used to volunteer. I've done 4th grade, 5th grade, 6th grade. I've done junior high. Junior high was fun. I did high school. And then I did kindergarten. And I was supposed to go and talk about nutrition to a bunch of little tiny kids and, mm-hmm. Show pictures and do that kind of stuff. And I did it for 2 hours. Like I did 30 minutes and they took a break, another 30, and then they went to lunch and they came back and I was fucking exhausted. And I was like, I don't know how teachers control this many children this age. It's insane. Yeah. It's absolutely requires
I'll a ridiculous. My mind.
Oh dude, I was so exhausted afterwards. I didn't know how they did. I remember when I left, I told her, I'm like, you're a champion. No. I don't know how you did it. I was totally
those are great examples. No, I just immediately thought of astronauts. I don't know. Because, like, I'm a sci-fi geek.
Are you watching that show right now? The Disney?
Just started, so don't quiz me.
Okay.
But yeah,
okay.
It's good so far. But yeah, just to see, like, what they go through and, like, and they rarely ever even get to go to space, and just to see, like, how brilliant you have to be to start, right? You got to be, like, an astrophysicist. You have to have, like,
they're
all
everything.
The pedigrees, of everything.
Yeah. You got to be able to build a rocket on top of
it. You got to build it. You got to problem solve under like extreme conditions. Like you got to be in inhospitable places.
Super athletes,
super athletes. Like, there's no appeal for me like to go to space. As much as I love sci-fi, like there's nothing out there for us. What the fuck are we doing? Like there's nothing. You can't terraform these places. Like they're just it's just like the worst desert possible with no air to breathe.
So. Yeah, they're like as close to superhuman as you could imagine.
Yeah,
I remember when you went up and flew in the jet with the fighter pilot.
Yep.
And he
Major
took
Jason.
How
yeah,
many
Markson.
How many G's did he take you?
He did 9.3.
Yeah. Now imagine flying 9 G's and knowing what you're doing.
Yeah.
Like How do you do that?
I don't know. Like, it's totally, like, it's baffling to me. That's a great example, because a lot of those guys, like, you know, the top tier, like, fighter pilots, like, some of them go, you know, into the space programs and stuff after that, but... Yeah, even them, they have, like, they're brilliant, and they're you know, physically crazy with all that stuff.
That's insane. Look, Mind Pump is recorded on video as well as audio. Come find us on YouTube, Mind Pump Podcast. You can also find all of us on Instagram. Look for Justin at Mind Pump Justin. You can find me at Mind Pump Sal and Adam at Mind Pump Adam. Now, the next one, this one's also very important, and that's to eat carbohydrates. If you've ever gone on a low-carb diet, you know that you start to notice a reduction in performance, mm-hmm. and then if you're somebody that enjoys the pump, it kind of starts to disappear. And this is because carbohydrates attract water into the body.